the darkness you shine.
Into the darkness you shine.
Out of the ashes we rise.
Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you.
None like you.
None like you.
Our God is greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
What are you turning to?
Open the eyes of the blind.
None like you.
None like you.
Into the darkness you shine.
Into the darkness you shine.
Out of the ashes we rise.
Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you.
None like you.
None like you.
Oh, our God is greater. If our God is with us, What can stand again?
Come on, say God is for us. Come on, say God is for us.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loved. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that may this heart adore. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am. Want to say
that you're my God.
You're all together lovely, all together worthy,
all together wonderful to me.
King of all days, King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above, and above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake, became poor.
Oh,
here today in our celebration. Beulah Heights, the homecoming, everything. But the truth of the matter is, we are what we are by the grace of God. There comes a time when we take the whole of who we are, every accomplishment, every failure, everything that we've done, and we lay it at his feet. I'm amazed at how he's able to take nothing and make something. So today, just for a moment, can you just build your own little personal altar and just say, God, here I am. Here I am to worship you. Here I am. We have the privilege, Father, of coming into your presence, the privilege of drawing near. We worship you today. We honor you today. Thank you for the tremendous price that was paid for us. We're not cheap. It cost you your life, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
To see my sins upon you, thought I was worth saving. You can't change my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you clean me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrifice your life so I could be free. So I could be whole. So I
Isn't that amazing? He thought you were worth it. He thought you were worth it. Let's give him honor today. Give him the glory. Let's do his name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord this morning.
Morning. It's a good day. This is a day the Lord has made. We rejoice and are glad in it. It's my duty to reflect. Now, I'm not sure what that all entails, because I've been here 51 years and I could stand here all day and reflect on what good things the Lord has done for us. You know, you don't ever want to remember the bad things. You want to reflect on the good things. God's been good to us. Such a great God. Now, I've only got a few minutes, so I'm going to try and speak fast. Now, I don't normally speak fast, but I'm going to try and speak fast and I don't try to cover the whole 51 years, but I'm going to hit some highlights. Beginning with the year 1964, when in a conference room in Michigan, I've been pastoring a church in Midland, Michigan for 6.5 years at that time, getting ready to build a new church, had every intention of staying in the cold country. But the Board of Trustees of Beulah Heights then Actually, the name was Beulah Heights College, Seminary, and Institute. A very long name. Especially the fact that they had less than 25 students. So, but the Board of Trustees called me into a meeting with them, an urgent meeting. And they said, they didn't say you're our last hope. They just simply said, if you don't agree to this, we may have to close the school. Just prior to that, they had to fire the gentleman that was a dean because he was doing things that was not ethical. My wife and I, they said, you got to let us know. This week, we have to know. This was August of 1964. The school was to open September 1st of 1964. And this is the first word I had of it. And we were in a week-long conference. So my wife and I immediately prayed about it, said, is this what we feel God wants us to do, even in light of all that we felt like we'd be given up? And we both agreed. And that's the important thing. You know, if I had said we're going to go and my wife had said, uh-uh, that would have been a bad thing, wouldn't it? But when you both agree because you feel that God has moved on your heart to say, yes, this is the direction I want you to go. And probably another reason, because I was the only one that had a degree in the conference. With the exception of one gentleman, I think, who pastored a church in North Carolina, but he had no intention of giving up that church and coming here. We agreed with the board that we would come. They said, well, there's no money. We have a $300 mortgage payment, and we can't pay the mortgage payment a month. And if you agree to come, we'll give you $100 a month. $1,200 a year, because they needed the dean to be here 12 months. The faculty at that time were only paid for 9 months. They were paid $450 a year, not a month. $450 a year. Tuition at that time, for you students that are here, tuition at that time was $8.25 an hour. That meant you could take a three-hour class for about $25. Now it costs you, what, $600 for a three-hour class? And if you're... And if you're in graduate school, I think it's $900 or $1,000. I'm not sure. We can't keep up with the cost. But we agreed because we felt God said, that's what you should do. I was 25 years old, had a child 2 years old. We went home, resigned the church suddenly, left them without a pastor because I had to be here by September 1st. School year was supposed to start. Well, lo and behold, when we got here, nobody knew anything. I called the faculty together and said, are we ready for the semester? They said, ready for what? We don't know what we're supposed to teach. We haven't ordered any books. Now, I was new to this game. You know, I wasn't trained at that point to be an educational administrator. That came in time. And I said, Lord, what in the world are we going to do? It's ready to open school. Nobody knows what they're going to teach. We don't have any textbooks. We have less than 25 students. What are we going to do? Well, to make a long story short, God intervened, and we were able to get things set up such as they were. And one of those early faculty meetings, as the Lord started to allow new students to come, I challenged the faculty about growth. And one of the elderly faculty lady said, we don't want growth. We just want to remain small and spiritual. Wow. As if you grow, you can't be spiritual. But that was the mentality of the faculty that I had to deal with in 1964. And the board was just about like that at that time. The Lord has taken all of them to heaven now, so except one. There's still one who's still with us. But God was faithful in those early years. When we backed our truck up to what was then the old Barth home, sitting where the administration building sits now, an old 14-room house that had served as the girls' dorm, as the dining room. There were two or three faculty that lived in there. The president had lived in one room of that house at one time, Hattie Barth, before the Lord took her. And we backed the truck up. My wife walked into the living room. All that was there was bare wood floors. No carpet, no rugs, no linoleum, no tile, just a bare, if you remember the old houses that were, this house was built as a farmhouse just after the Civil War, and it had old planks. The windows didn't match, so in the wintertime, when the wind blew, the curtains stood out. We had individual heaters in each room. There's no such thing as central heat, and the only central air we had was the fact that we had so many cracks in the building that air came in. The school financially was so, and I don't know any better word than to say destitute, that the only telephone on campus was a payphone that hung on our living room wall. That was the sole phone of Beulah Heights. Then we renamed. We got rid of some of these names and dropped them, and we became Beulah Heights College at that time. So if you wanted to make a phone call, I had to get a roll of coins from the treasurer. I think back then it was a nickel or a dime, and I used that to make phone calls. And if somebody was going to call the college, they called on our payphone. And so somebody in the living room had to answer the payphone. Giving you some reflection on what the Lord has done for us. To look back now, it almost seems unreal. God has, you can see the results of the campus today. The results of men and women who actually gave their life. The Barths did not have children. They gave everything they had to the work of the Lord. Everything. All the land, everything they had went to the work of the Lord. And when Sister Barth finally passed away, there really was no estate because everything had been given to the work of the Lord. Now that's the way God sustained Beulah Heights Bible Institute, then Beulah Heights College, and then Beulah Heights Bible College, and now Beulah Heights University. God has been the provider. In the 97-year history that we're celebrating today, getting close to the 100th year, there have been 8 presidents in those 97 years. I've had the privilege of working with 5 of those 8. And the last 4, including Dr. Kranja, were my students at one time. Because for the first 27 years that I was here as dean, I was also a professor. Out of necessity, there was no money, so it was incumbent to teach. And I think probably the last year I taught was maybe when Dr. Kranja, the year he graduated. That's been 24 years ago, I guess. But that's excitement to see Dr. Kranja, before him his predecessor, Dr. Chan, who, if you had told me in 1973 when he came from India as a raw student, that some years later he would become president of Beulah Heights Bible College, I would have said, God is in the miracle business. But I think this is even asking him too much. And Dr. Chan will probably say something about that when he speaks. But he recalls often the times that I had to call him into my office and say, Sam, you either get your act together or we're going to see that you have a one-way trip back to India. But see what God did. See what God did. If we had made the mistake and had not been willing to go the extra mile with a student and had dismissed what is now Dr. Chan as a student, where would that have left him? Where would he be today? I have no idea. God had a plan for his life. And some people even probably felt we erred and were too easy. But I'd rather err on that side, knowing that God still can change people and work in the lives of people. And so we did. And look what ministry God has blessed Dr. Chan with today. And then Dr. Karanja. You know, this is what makes the position I held for 49 years all worthwhile. It's those that God has raised up. And then when I see and hear of young men and women, not only in this country, but around the world, that are serving the Lord, and hear reports of the things that are being done, and the souls that are being saved, and the works that are being formed, that's excitement. That's passion. That's what keeps passion flowing, realizing that you had maybe just a little bit to do with what God has accomplished in their life. It's just amazing what God has done. Dr. Chan and I, and I'm going to sit down. Dr. Chan and I, in 1992, Sam came as president in 1989. We were not accredited by a recognized accrediting agency. We had, at the time he came, about 89 students. We had fluctuated between 115 to in the 80s. But growth began slowly. And as we grew, we decided we had to have accreditation from a government-recognized agency. And so Dr. Chan and I, in November of 92, decided to travel to Nashville, Tennessee, where TRACS, the Transnational Association of Christian Colleges and Schools, were having their annual conference, their annual accrediting meeting. And we sat in on some of their sessions. But as we traveled there, we were dreaming of where we may be someday. And I remember in discussing with Dr. Chan, we would say, won't it be amazing and wonderful if someday Beulah Heights Bible College can have 200 students? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't that be a miracle if someday we could have 200 students? We were dreaming then, because at that time we only had about half that many. And Bible colleges normally were not that large to begin with. We sat in on one of their meetings, decided we wanted to apply. But when we filled out an application, we suddenly realized that their statement of faith said, we do not accredit Pentecostal or charismatic schools. And so Dr. Chan and I talked with the board at that time, their board of directors, and said, listen, we would like to be a part of your accrediting body, but we can't apply. Because at that time we were traditional Pentecostal Bible college. Do you know, and here's where God's grace and his leading takes place. Do you know their board of directors met at that meeting and changed their bylaws so that that Pentecostal colleges or charismatic colleges could apply and receive accreditation. That wasn't a happenstance. That was God. And we have seen God's hand all along in the way he has led Beulah Heights Bible College and now Beulah Heights University. From having a 3-year diploma to a 4-year degree, and then now offering master's degrees, both in leadership, religious studies, business, also an undergraduate degree in business, a doctor of ministry degree, and now a new PhD degree in leadership. Think of where God has brought us from. Thank God. We just have to give him the glory. And we also recognize a great staff that have sacrificed to make themselves available to Beulah Heights University. We're not looking through the rearview mirror today. Change doesn't come by looking through the rearview mirror. Now, it's okay to look back to see where God brought us from. But we're not looking through the rearview mirror. We're looking ahead. And I believe, with all sincerity, and it's not a cliche of mine, I believe that if we're good stewards of what God has blessed us with, and we do continue to do his will, our best days as a university is still ahead of us. Yeah. I believe that. I believe God's going to take us to much greater heights than probably we can imagine. I could not, in 92, Dr. Chan, and I could not have imagined that we would someday be a university, someday have 600, 700, 800 students. We couldn't dream that much, but God had a plan. And if you work his plan, and you stay in his will, and you do his bidding above everything else, you know, sometimes it's easier to run than to stand. But God calls on us to stand. And for those who stood, look where Beulah Heights University is today. Thank God for what he has done, and thank God for what he is going to do. God bless you. Have a wonderful time.
God for
give us all these phones anyway. And never carry phone in the in chapel. Alright. But that's my wife's fault. I was waiting for her to call me that she's on the way, but I didn't know she sneaked in already. Okay, let's do something very special. And normally at Beulah Heights, we try to recite something that always pushes us in the next few hours, days, years, and time. So I'm just going to start. This is my day. This is my season. I thank God for calling me. I thank God for choosing me. Even though I don't deserve it. God is excellent. I will strive for excellence. In Jesus' name, amen. I just want to say thank you so much, Dr. Keeler, for your reflection. To serve an institution for more than 51 years, that is not a small thing. And I, when I came in as a student, I remember was my only job that I could get at that time was a janitor, was picking up the trash in classes and faculty places, cutting glass and all those. And one day, Dr. Keeler wanted to give me something, this African boy who don't have shoes. So he gave me a shoes, which is size 16, and I wear 9. So I tried to stack in, I tried to put in some paper towels so that it can fit me, but it almost knocked me down. And I said, if God gives me strength and time, I'll come back as president to torment him. So I have been trying to do that all the time. But he is a great guy. He's a great asset for us. And your wisdom always prevails in everywhere. So we thank you so, so very much. I want to take this opportunity to welcome all the visitors who are with us here today. I can see so many new faces, and I want you to know that you're not visiting. This is your home. Almost 97 years ago, this couple, the Baths, set this place aside for the glory of God. So when you're here, you are within your kingdom. You are a citizen of heaven, and this is your place. So I want you to feel very strong and walk boldly without fear, knowing this is your home. For the learners that were coming back, I want to welcome you back. There's so many changes that have happened. Some of them, you appreciate them. Some of them, you question them. But it's all right, because things always don't happen the way we think, isn't it? Things don't happen the way we plan and how we think it's going to be. The founders thought that this is going to be just a small institution, about 20 people, train them as ministers and send them away to different countries. They sent them to South America. They sent them to Africa, especially in Kenya and India. But see what God has done. So you never know what God has in store for you. I'm so honored to have so many guests, and I'll be introducing them later on. Bishop Martin with us here today. Dr. Han, all the way from South Korea, and I'll be introducing him. And many, many others that are here. Now, if I started naming names, I'll miss some. But there was one student, from Beulah Heights, the class of 1941. And she is here with us. Would you stand so that we can love you and say, a class of 1941. Class of 1941. She is 94 years old, and she is beautiful, strong. And yesterday, her daughter, if you could stand, she said that is her real hair. So we need to know what she eats. She does not put any color or anything. That's her natural hair. I need to know. I lost mine. So we thank God for that. Thank you. We love you. We honor you. I went to the church where she was, and the daughter was sitting behind me, and he said, you know, my mother was in class of 1941, and she's planning to come tomorrow. I mean, on Tuesday. And you know what? The guys who are in that age, in that time, they has what you call tenacity. This is what we are lacking today, a tenacity to push on. You know what she said? I'm not going to wait until Tuesday. I want to go and visit there. And she was here yesterday afternoon. And she talked to the faculty. I wish we can even have just a little bit of percentage of this tenacity that you all have. Because with this tenacity, that's why the founders were able to say, we're going to start an institution known as Beulah Heights. I'll be doing a grave sin and a mistake if I don't recognize the first lady of Beulah Heights, and I'll be paying that when I go home. You didn't even recognize. You say you didn't do this. You didn't even know these things. So let us love our first lady, Miss Esther Karanja, who is with us today. Beautiful. We thank you so much. Thank you so much for all of you to be here today. It's a great moment. And what we're trying to do, we're trying to remember and to prepare ourselves for the 100 years anniversary. And when I ask myself, what does that really mean? What does the 100 years anniversary mean? We will be celebrating on July the 27th, 2018. So this is a preparation for that. This is a rehearsal of what is going to happen. But it's for us, for me, I think it's for us to remind ourselves that there were two people who denied themselves for you and I. And the second thing is to remind you that the ministry, the way of doing ministry nowadays have changed. And the same way, the way of teaching the people in the ministry is also changing. And if we do not embrace those changes and start understanding what does that mean, we're going to be caught up. And we'll be caught up in a very strange way that we will look back and say, how did that happen? I told the faculty yesterday, and many pastors who are here, they are witness to that. Many churches today, they're not 100% capacity. We are at 75, 85. If you have 90% capacity, you're doing very well. I met with a brother from Washington. They had a church with 20,000 plus members, and no scandal, no nothing. And the church now is about 14, it's fluctuating between 14 and 16,000 people. They have tried everything to see what's happening, but they can't understand. But we are in the age that we call it on demand. On demand is an age whereby anything you want, if you want to watch a video, you can be at the beach and you're watching the video. You can be in the airplane and you're watching the video. That's what the age is, on demand. Anything that you need, you can get that on demand. I told somebody else the other day, nowadays you don't have to go through the dictionary to check on things. The other day, Esther and I were debating, and we asked ourselves, when was Bill Clinton born? How is Bill Clinton? Oh, how old is he? And I say, you know what? Let's ask Google. And Google comes and tells us right there. You know, before that, we'll argue, we'll say, no, he did this and all that. Now we have that answer. Now, as pastors, you can't say, the Lord told me. You know, the Lord spoke to me, and he said this. Because somebody is Googling and say, oh, the Lord told you. It's Google who told you that. Google told you this is what is going to happen. So the ministry is changing. The ministry is changing, and the people we are ministering to are changing. And if you're not be careful, we're going to be, in the next 20 years, we're going to be like what is happening or what happened in Europe. Big cathedrals, but empty. Wow. Esther and I were there just last year speaking for another bishop for their Easter Sunday, and through the window we were looking at one big, big cathedral, and you know what? It's now a nightclub. Wow. We went down again. There's one that they opened, and they open only during Easter and Christmas, and you can just walk in and pray. There's no pastor, there's nobody. That's what is happening. People are just there. Then we saw another one which has now been turned to be an ice skating. And we asked ourselves, what really happened? How did that happen to a time whereby they were sending missionaries, they were just coming to Africa, and they became people like David Livingstone and so forth, and now they are all empty. And I want to tell you that if you're not careful, we are headed to that place right now. And we need to change that, and I think that is why Beulah Heights is here and other Christian colleges and Bible colleges. And I'm going to give you some data from only one denomination. If you look at the Baptist, which is the largest denomination in the U.S. right now, the average age of a pastor is 55 years old right now. And normally the Baptist, from the data we have, it shows that they retire at 63, 62, 65 years old. So what happens now, that means that in the next 10 years, there will be over 180,000 positions that will need to be filled. Ask yourself, that is only one denomination. Ask yourself, how are we preparing our young people to become the ministers and to fill the pulpit? We know we don't. Because we think because I'm anointed, because I'm called, I can just do the ministry. And that's fine. You can do that. But I don't think Jesus was so dumb to know that he can call his disciples and say, you know what? I have to spend 3 years with you to prepare you for what is going to happen. And I think that is where we miss, where we don't have time to prepare ourselves and to prepare those that we feel they have been called in the ministry and to say, go to Beulah Heights, take one course. Go to this Bible college, go and take one course. Let them refine, let them continue unearthing what is in you. That's why Beulah Heights is there. That's why our founders knew that even though God had given them a vision to start a church and to start a ministry, they needed also to train people before they got the field. Bishop Martin, I was telling the faculty yesterday, our ministry, our professional, is the only professional where anyone can come out and say without any training, and say I'm being called, and therefore I need to preach. And you know what? Ministry is tough because you trust people are trusting you with their life. And I asked them this question. If I went to Delta and one day I say, this is Benson Karanja, I've never flown any time, but I'm going to be flying with you for the first time, and we believe that we're going to make it. I tell you what, people will be fighting to get out of the door and say, hey, you're on your own, go die. You just go die by yourself. But we trust that because God has shown us to do that. But we make mistakes because the data is also showing that 60 to 65 churches that are being started, they are all failing. 65, that's a huge number. And you need to know that when you start the ministry, it takes between 1 year to 5 years. If you pass 5 years, you will succeed. But between 1 year and 5 years, you're still struggling and scrambling, and you need to push, you need to move. So I'm just here today as we celebrate these 100 years, as we prepare to do that, to rethink differently. To rethink differently. For the churches, if there's people who really you feel they've been called to the ministry, please direct them. Direct them to the seminaries, to the colleges, where they can be refined and be helped. Because it's a tragic. It's a tragic. It's a tragic when you think that you're anointed. You know, Bishop, we've been used to healing people when they say, I brought the house down. God did not choose you to bring the house down. He brought you. He chose you to build the house. Man, I wasn't father. I brought the house down. Man, you could hear me. But if you go back and we were all jumping and sweating and you look at that and you ask yourself, what was he teaching about? What was he really talking about? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. And they jumped and they do everything. About 2 months ago, Esther and I, we went to a certain church. I'm not going to say. And the young pastor preached his heart out. Then when we walked out, we said, what was the message, really? What was the message? And there was no message. And you know what? He is anointed. I have no doubt you're anointed. But remember, there was a time a young boy was called, and he had to go to the pastor and say, I had the voice. And I say, okay, when you hear the voice again, this is what you say. God had already chosen the boy, but he needed somebody to guide him through, So I'm just asking you. So you ask yourself, what is Beulah Height? And I want to tell you, Beulah Height is to refine the things that God has put in you, help you to dig deep into you and see what God has done for you. The second part, because I know I got great preachers, I need to sit down and let them come. But this is what I wanted also to say something. We need your support. We can't do this without the support of your ministries. I would like for everybody. People say, I don't have the money. I don't have the money. But it's not about the money. It's about your heart being there. I'm reading a report from a president, and they raised over $7 million. And they said 38% of that money that they raised last year was from people who gave $100 per year or less. So everything that you commit to give and you do that is going somewhere. However, if you look at Dr. Karanja, I'm a human being. I'm going to disappoint you. I'm going to disappoint you because I'm not Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you something that Jesus told Peter so many years ago. And this is what Jesus said to Peter. Peter, you know you denied me just a few days ago? And you know, Peter was scared about that because he knew what he had done. But Jesus said, do you love me? And Jesus said, yes, I do. Amen. Peter said, yes, I do. And he was the same three times he denied him. He asked him the same three times whether he loved him. And the reason why, because Jesus could see somebody beyond Peter, inside Peter. Just the same way he saw not a shepherd boy within David, he saw the king of Israel. So Jesus could see something special, but he had to prepare him. And he said, you love me? And he said, take care of my sheep, take care of my lamb, take care of my flock. And this is how I translate this. There are many things we can never do. There are many things we cannot do if we don't love Jesus Christ. Mother Teresa said, she was asked this question, how do you hug these people who are smelling and all that? She said, I can't. And the guy looked at him and said, I saw you hug these people. He said, I don't hug them. I will not love them. Mother Teresa will not love them. But when I hug them, I'm hugging Jesus Christ. Their face disappears and I'm connected with loving Jesus Christ. And that's exactly what Peter was telling. That's what Jesus was telling Peter. The ministry I'm going to give you is a tough one. People are going to deny you. People are going to love you or hate you. And you can never love you as being Peter. But when you see me there, when you love me, when you connect with me, then you can do the ministry. So that's exactly what I'm saying today. That when you think about the ministry, when you think about Beulah Heights, when you give $20, when you give $100, when you give $50, don't think about me. Think about helping the kingdom. The last 10 years, we have brought, we do have more than 100 and plus from Korea. And they're here. When Ebola was going on in Liberia, we trained about 6 pastors who could not even make it to go to the cities. They were using their bicycles to go to a computer cafe to do the work. We've gone to Congo, some places that you not have thought. Right now, I'm telling you that one of our students who graduated from Congo, he is now the director of the cabinet in Congo. I went to his house. Just you walk through the president's house and you are there. And I enjoyed when they saluted me when I walked in there. But the point I'm trying to say is that when you do something, you're doing something that probably in your life you will never know that why did I plant that seed? But God is going to reward you many, many times. many of you who are here the other day, we had a student from Liberia. We prayed for that student. You all saw the emotion with that brother. We prayed. When I asked people to come and lay hands on him on that day, I remember, you know, some people feared. I said, he's from Liberia. And some of them just pretended they're gone. So I saw some people walk out of there. And we laid hands on that brother. And we laid a hand on him. I said, if we get it, that's okay. But he was all right. And by now, he said, thank God, my mother is still there. I can go back. I'm not called to be in America. I'm going back. Liberia is free from these diseases. So think about that couple who gave this place and set this place aside or apart for this kingdom. And now it is your responsibility. It is your season. It is your time. It is my season. It is my time to do the same thing for the next 100 years to come. So would you join me to do that? And I ask you to pray hard, to talk about Beulah Heights, and to encourage your parishioners, your members, to tell them there is a school on Burn Street that can help you, that will refine you, that will make you to be what God called you for. I think I've given you so many things right now. What I need to do, let's hear our speaker. The brother that is about to come to speak to us, Dr. Yeong-hun Han, he's the brother that first of all I met in South Korea. And you never know. When you see people, you never know what kind of influence they have. The first time I went to Korea, Dr. Kim drove me through Dr. Yang Chul's church. We were just driving through the street. Just a small city by itself. I didn't know that within a year, I'll be standing on the pulpit of Dr. Yang Chul to speak at 7 o'clock, at 7 a.m. service with more than 12,000 members. And Dr. Han made that connection. Very well connected, and I appreciate him. He's a visionary leader. He's president of one of the Christian universities, very well known in Seoul, and very well respected. We just signed a memorandum of understanding with a student whereby we'll have exchange of professors and students. We'll send students to Korea and some of our professors there, and they will do the same thing to us. And all that happened because of Dr. Han and Dr. Jo and Dr. Kim, and we thank them for that. Thank you so much. He's a visionary leader in South Korea, serving since 1974 under the direction of God. Dr. Han is the founding and senior pastor of West Seoul Central Church in Seoul, Korea. He currently serves as the honor president of Hanyang University. That is the same thing as president emeritus. Dr. Han served as the chairman of the World Evangelical Council Church of Korea, Evangelical Theological College. He has served several organizations to develop churches in Korea. Dr. Han continues to strive to serve with excellence in his local church, Dr. Han Yang University Through God. And if I'm pronouncing the names wrong, please excuse me. Dr. Han earned a bachelor's degree from Lee University and a Master's of Divinity from Pentecostal Theological Seminary in North Carolina. He earned a Doctor of Ministry from California Theological Seminary and a PhD from Faith Evangelical College. Dr. Han makes his home in Seoul, South Korea, with his beautiful wife, who is with us here today, Yan John Shim, and his two sons. Would you please join me with the love of Beulah Heights and that spirit to welcome Dr. Han, my dear friend.
seated.
Morning.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. And you say, where is Peter?
Amen.
Where's Peter? Oh, you there. Let me repeat again. Hallelujah. No. You listen to Peter. Hallelujah. Louder. What? Louder. Okay.
오늘 여러분 학교에 오게 된 것을 개인적으로 굉장히 영광스럽게 생각합니다.
I really honor that you invite me here, Dr. Carranza, and all Beulah University professors and students.
또 한 가지 양해를 구하는 것은 제가 영어로 여러분들에게 말씀을 드려야 되는데 우리나라 말로 말씀을 드리게 돼서 아주 죄송스럽게 생각합니다.
Really, even though he speaks English very well, maybe he speaks better than me, but you see, he's such a so humble, and he said, I really like to preach in English, but I'd rather preach in Korean.
I don't think so.
I don't know if Dr. Kim is right or not.
제가 미국에서 공부를 했습니다만은
Even though I studied at the United States, several universities,
예, 발음이 많이 좋지 않아서
My pronunciation still like a kimchi pronunciation. What pronunciation? 김치 pronunciation.
제가 어느 날 새벽에 교회 가서 기도를 했습니다.
Today early morning I went to church. I prayed for today for Dr. Grant and all professors and all the students.
이 학교에서 초청을 받았는데 내가 영어로 가서 이야기를 해야 됩니까? 우리나라 말로 해야 됩니까? 이렇게 하나님 앞에 물었습니다.
I asked to God that what I'm going to use the language either I preach in English or Korean.
그랬더니 하나님께서 성령을 통해서 감동을 주시기를
The Holy Spirit touched me and
이렇게 말씀했습니다.
Holy Spirit, God said to me
너 잘못하는 영어로 발음도 좋지 않은데 듣는 사람들 귀를 괴롭게 하지 말고
Don't make it trouble and difficulties of our ears who are hearing his message.
영어를 잘하는 김 박사님이 그 학교에 있으니까 그분의 도움을 받는 것이 좋겠다. 하나님께서 그렇게 저에게 말씀을 해주셔서 okay. 제가 순종하기로 그렇게 따르고 우리나라 말로 하기로 했습니다.
He's so such a humble. And well, you don't have to speak in English because you have Dr. Kim and he can help you.
제가 이 카란자 총장님을 몇 년 전에 만났는데 미국 사람 만난 중에서 굉장히 제가 핸섬하다 아주 미남이다 그렇게 생각을 했습니다.
I met several lot of American men and women and I believe that Dr. Carranza is the most handsome man in the whole world. Hallelujah. Thank you Jesus.
오늘 아침에도 제가 이렇게 총장님 그 접견실에 만났는데 위에서부터 이렇게 쫙 한번 훑어보니까 밑에 구두가 반짝반짝하고 이 머리도 좀 반짝반짝하고 그 다음에 옷차림도 너무 핸섬했습니다.
And this morning we had a little coffee fellowship and I saw Dr. Carranza. He looks so handsome, shining and glory. From his top of the head, shining, and his shoes, shining. He all dressed so beautiful to his eyes.
그리고 여기 한번 봐주시기 바랍니다.
I want to watch his he wearing badge.
이 배지 이 배지가 말하고 있는 의미가 뭔 줄 아십니까?
Do you understand what means his badge? What? No.
Why don't I know? 이 배지는 이 학교를 상징하는 이제 심볼입니다.
This badge symbol of Beulah University. Amen.
그래서 오늘 총장님께서 직접 여기 해줬는데 저는 오늘부터 이 학교의 멤버가 된 겁니다.
Yeah, since Dr. Carranza gave me this badge, from now on, he is a member of Beulah University.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so very much.
그리고 이 김 박사님하고 저하고는 같은 해에 태어났습니다.
And Dr. Kim and I, we born in this world the same year.
1945년도에 태어났는데
We were born in 1945.
내가 이렇게 오늘 오면서 물었습니다. 김 박사님 이제 몇 살이나 됩니까? 그랬더니 이렇게 대답을 했어요.
I asked Dr. Kim that how old are you now?
뭐라고 이제 대답을 했냐면 안 닭띠 될 뻔 했습니다. 그렇게 대답을 했습니다.
And we Korea use each 12 years. We have a special year. We are born in year of chicken. And next year we're going to be dog, year of a dog. Next year is year of a sheep. So we were born in same year, which is year of a chicken.
Somebody don't understand what you say there. 아, 이 안 닭띠라고 하는 말은 같은 해 태어났지만은 이제 1월 달이나 5월 달이나 6월 달에 태어나지 아니하고 내가 I guess December maybe November was born이라고 그렇게 생각해서 이야기했더니 굉장히 나더러 스마트하다고 그렇게 이야기를 해 주었습니다.
And I guess Dr. Kim born in the month of November or December, which means he attempted to, he's getting a little older than me. And he asked me, what month of that year you were born?
I said that December. 안 닭띠 될 뻔했다 그런 뜻입니다.
That means I was almost not year of a chicken.
He's a joke to me, so I was, loud laugh, 크게 웃었습니다.
And then we laugh and we have a good joke this morning.
오늘 여기 함께한 총장님이나 또는 교수님이나 그리고 직원들, 그리고 학생들, 그리고 동문들 여러분 앞에 다시 한번 이 학교가 97년 됐다고 하는 것에 대해서 자랑스럽게 생각할 만하다고 그러저는 그렇게 생각합니다.
I really respect this school because 97 years. I really respect, honor, and love you, all Dr. Grants and all the professors and staffs and students, everybody. I really love you all.
Thank you so much.
He said, 대단히 감사합니다. He said in English, I speak and interpret okay. Korean. Yeah. So, 감사합니다.
If I say English, going to interpret in Korean, if I say Korean, going to interpret English.
Yeah, like Dr. Kim does all the times when he's a preacher speaking Korean, I interpret to English, and the preacher is speaking in English, I interpret to Korean. Amen. Yes.
오늘 저는 여러분들에게 십자가의 능력에 대해서 잠시 말씀을 드리기를 원합니다.
I want to today share you word of God that title, The Power of the Cross.
예, 하나님의 말씀은 고린도전서 1장 18절에서 24절 말씀인데 내 대신 우리 김 박사님께서 영어로 하나님 말씀을 소개해 드리겠습니다.
Today I want to share the scripture 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 18 through 24. If you have a Bible, would you look it up? And the 1 Corinthians chapter 1:18. Let me read quickly. For the message of the cross is a foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. And Allison, you have a Bible? Anybody, would you mind read the scripture? Oh, yes, Jackie, thank you. Let's give her a big hand. Jackie, hallelujah. She's the director of the register. She was, okay.
First Corinthians chapter 1, beginning with verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Did you finish until verse 24? Oh, okay. All right. Okay, now we are understanding what preacher Dr. Han is going to preach.
여기 본문 말씀에서 여러분 특별히 18절 말씀을 보아주시고 24절 말씀을 보아주시면 고맙겠습니다.
I want to focusing on verse 18 and verse 24.
18절 말씀을 보게 되면 이런 말씀입니다. 여러분들이 이미 아시는 바와 같이 그 십자가의 도가 멸망하는 자들에게는 미련한 것이지만 구원받은 우리에게는 하나님의 능력, 하나님의 능력, 하나님의 능력이라 이렇게 표현하고 있습니다.
Here verse will say that the word of the cross is to those who are perishing foolishness, but to us who are being saved, it is power of God. Amen?
그런가 하면은 24절 마지막 절에도 보면 하나님의 능력이라고 하는 말씀이 나오고 있습니다.
Verse 24 mention about that the power of God.
십자가는 우리 기독교의 상징이자 복음의 핵심이라는 사실을 기억해야 됩니다.
And here mention about that the cross is a symbol of Christianity and the center of gospel. Amen.
그래서 십자가가 없으면 복음도 없다는 사실을 우리가 기억해야 될 줄로 믿습니다.
Therefore without the cross, there is no what gospel.
오늘 저는 여러분들에게 세 가지 말씀을 드릴 텐데 첫째는 이겁니다. 십자가의 능력은 구원이라는 말씀이고 두 번째 말씀은
Today I want to share the three main topics. Number one, the power of cross means salvation.
두 번째 십자가의 능력은 화해라는 말씀이고 계속하세요.
Second,
세 번째 말씀은 십자가의 능력은 승리라고 이렇게 말씀드리고 싶습니다.
I'd like to share the second. The power of cross is reconciliation. Third, the power of the cross is V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. Victory. All victory in Jesus. Amen.
사랑하는 성도 여러분 그리고 여기 같이 한 동역자 여러분.
Brothers and sisters,
구원의 뜻이라는 것이 무엇인지 여러분들이 너무나 잘 알 것입니다.
I believe you know the meaning of salvation.
하나님께서 요한복음 3장 16절에 보면 하나님 세상을 이처럼 사랑하사 독생자를 주셨으니 누구든지 저를 믿는 자마다 멸망치 아니하고 구원을 얻게 할 것이라 이렇게 말씀을 했습니다.
As you everybody understanding that the John 3:16, God so loved the world, whosoever believe in God, and then what?
그래서 우리에게는 좋은 소식이라는 게 말씀입니다.
That's why according to the John 3:16, and the gospel is good news. Amen?
구원받은 여러분과 저는 확실하게 다섯 가지를 이제 믿어야 될 줄로 믿습니다.
And everybody who have an experience of a salvation would think several, maybe five things.
오직 예수를 믿어야만이 구원받을 수 있으며
Number one, if you want to experience a salvation, you got to believe Jesus and Him as our personal Savior. Amen?
그리고 우리가 아름다운 선한 일을 하게 될 때에 축복을 받습니다.
When we have good things in the name of Jesus, God gonna bless you with many wonderful things.
그런가 하면은 심은대로 거두게 하신 하나님이라는 사실도 믿어야 됩니다.
And the Bible says, whatever you sowed, you will harvest, reap it.
그런가 하면 말하는 대로 된다는 사실도 믿어야 됩니다.
And then whatever you said, the seed of a word, you will harvest it.
그런 가면은 이제 믿음대로 된다는 사실도 우리가 알아야 됩니다.
And also we have to believe, understand that whatever you believe, then you will get it.
그런 가면 우리가 기도하는 대로 된다는 사실도 우리가 믿어야 됩니다.
And also we have to believe, trust that whatever we pray, God gonna answer you with the wonderful things.
우리가 구원의 확신을 가지려고 하게 되면은
if you want a confidence of the salvation,
다섯 가지를 또 믿어야 되는데
maybe you have to think of believe the five different kind.
하나님께서 사랑하는 독생자 아들 예수 그리스도를 이 땅에 보내 주신 것을 믿어야 됩니다.
Number one, you have to believe that God he sent his only begotten son Jesus Christ.
그런 가면 동정녀 마리아 탄생한 것을 믿어야 됩니다.
And also Jesus was born in at the Virgin Mary.
그다음에 두 번째로 생각할 것은 예수님께서 우리를 위해서 십자가에 죽으심을 믿어야 됩니다.
And also we have to believe that Jesus he died at the cross.
그런 가면은 이제 3일 만에 부활한 것을 믿어야 됩니다.
And also we all have to believe that his resurrection.
그리고 승천한 것을 믿어야 됩니다.
And also we have to believe that he ascend in the upstairs.
그리고 다시 오실 재림하실 주님을 믿어야 됩니다.
And also we have to believe Jesus who is going to return someday. Amen.
그것을 확신하지 못하게 되면은 여러분과 나는
If you do not have a confidence about these five different things,
구원 받았다고 생각할 수가 없습니다.
Maybe you doubt whether you have a salvation experience, salvation or not.
구원의 복음을 전할 수가 없습니다.
And it's very difficult to determine whether you saved or not.
그런데 십자가의 능력은 그런 구원의 역사를 이루는 놀라운 그런 힘이 있다는 사실을 우리가 기억해야 됩니다.
That's why I like to share today that these five different things. That's what the power of the cross.
그런가 하면 두 번째 십자가의 능력은 화해입니다.
And secondly, the power of the cross is reconciliation.
우리 예수님은 사랑의 모형이며 사랑의 화신이며 사랑을 전하기 위해서 이 땅에 오신 이제 하나님이십니다.
Jesus came to this world to show us for the love of God.
그런가 하면 우리 예수님은 용서의 하나님이라는 사실을 기억해야 됩니다.
And also Jesus is Jesus of forgiveness.
그렇기 때문에 우리는 예수 믿는 사람들이 이웃과 좋은 관계를 가지고 서로 사랑하면서 살아야 됩니다.
That's why we have to good relationship with our neighbors with a loving heart.
믿는 사람과 믿지 않는 사람이 다른 점이 있다고 하게 되면은
What a difference between the believers and non-believers.
우리는 예수 안에서 이해를 해줘야 되고 용서를 해줘야 되고 사랑을 해줘야 됩니다.
Number one, we have to understand others in Christ. Number two, we just love our neighbor as ourselves.
그렇기 때문에 다른 사람을 미워하거나 시기하거나 이제 해하거나 나쁜 마음을 갖거나 질투해서는 안 됩니다.
Therefore, we suppose not jealous others, but we have to love them.
나는 이렇게 말하고 싶습니다. 예수의 바보가 되자.
I really like to say that let's be a foolishness in Jesus Christ.
그 말은 조건 없이 사랑하고 that 그 말은 조건 없이
unconditional love.
조건 없이 용서하고
that means unconditional forgiveness.
그 말은 조건 없이 이해를 하자는 겁니다.
That means unconditional understand others.
예수님께서 산상복음에 이런 말씀을 했습니다.
Jesus said in the Bible, in Matthew,
합평케 하는 자는 복이 있나니 저희가 하나님의 아들이라 이렇게 일컫는다고 말씀했습니다.
Blessed are who reconciliation others, because
그렇기 때문에
he or she is going to be daughter or son of God.
그렇기 때문에 십자가의 능력은 화해라는 말씀을 기억해야 됩니다.
Therefore, I like we have to remember cross means understand and reconciliation.
우리가 잘 아는 아가페라고 하는 것은 그 사랑은 조건 없이 무조건 있는 대로 다 던져주는 것이 아가페 사랑인데 그게 십자가의 능력이라는 사실을 기억해야 될 줄로 믿습니다.
That's what we say the love of divine love. That means unconditional love. That means give it away. Not because of condition.
마지막 세 번째 십자가의 능력은 승리라는 사실을 기억해야 됩니다.
And last, and I like to say the power of the cross. That means the victory. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. One more. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. Dr. Mom, would you stand up, say, follow me? Louder, okay. V-I-C-T-O-R-Y. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Because it's a Dr. Om, he's chaplain to a chaplain officer, 22 years in Korean Army. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, Peter. I say hallelujah. Good, good. Okay.
여러분, 조용한 마음을 가지고 갈보리산 언덕에 십자가상의 주님을 한번 묵상해 보시기를 바랍니다.
I want to think about Jesus who died at the cross, Calvary.
당시 많은 사람들이 예수님을 따랐습니다.
So many people followed Jesus at that time.
예수님의 기적은 상상할 초월할 만큼 많은 이적들이 일어났습니다.
And Jesus, his ministry, all kind of miracle things.
베데스다 연못가에 38년 된 병자가 일어났는가 하면,
One person he has an incurable disease at the lake, but Jesus healed her.
해당장 야일의 딸이 죽은지 죽었다가 다시 살아났습니다.
And the daughter who charged for the synagogue, his daughter was healed.
나사라로 간 사람은 이제 죽은 지 나흘 만에 무덤에서 뚜벅뚜벅 걸어 나왔습니다.
As you know that Nazareth, he was dead for 4 days, but he alive.
상상할 수 없는 많은 기적과 이적이 예수님 당시 이곳저곳에서 일어났습니다.
So many miracle things happening through Jesus Christ. Amen.
그때 많은 사람들은 예수님을 정치적으로 생각을 했을 것입니다.
That time maybe so many people they think about Jesus as a political leader.
저 사람이 이 나라의 왕이 유대의 왕이 된다고 하게 되면은
and when if Jesus become a king of Israel
유대인들이 생각하게 될 때 우리는 힘 있는 사람이 되어서 하나님 앞에 영광 돌릴 뿐만 아니라 정치적으로 경제적으로 모든 위에서 다스릴 수 있는 자리에 간다고 생각했을 것입니다.
That time is a lot of people believe that if Jesus he king of Israel, not only everybody, you don't need a hospital, you don't need doctors, because Jesus is going to heal, and then that country is going to be a great country.
그런데 그 예수님께서 힘없이 십자가에서 돌아가셨습니다.
By the way, Jesus, he died at the cross. He looks has no power at all.
많은 사람들이 그것을 보고 실망하고 좌절하고 절망해 버렸습니다.
Therefore, a lot of people after they watch Jesus after he died at the cross, frustration, hopeless. Jesus is not no more powerful person anymore.
그분이 예수님이 굉장히 힘이 있는 그러한 그 유대인 왕이 될 줄 알고 따랐었는데.
Everybody believed that he was a powerful king of Israel.
로마 병정의 칼 끝과 창 끝에 힘없이 죽어갔습니다.
He died at the sword of a Roman soldiers.
그때 많은 사람들이 아 끝이 났구나 좌절하고 실망했습니다.
That times a lot of people believe that oh they frustrated, hopeless. Oh this is that's it. No more hope.
사랑하는 여러분.
My brothers and sisters.
중국에 가게 되면 공자의 무덤이 있습니다.
If you visit China, there is a famous man in China.
인도에 가게 되면은 여러분 이제 석가모니 묘가 있습니다.
If you visit India, there is also a great man over there.
사우디 아라비아 메카에 가게 되면은 여러분 잘 아는 마호메시의 무덤이 있습니다.
And if you go Saudi Arabia, there is also a great man.
그런 가면은 이스라엘 예루살렘에 가게 되면 역시 예수님의 무덤이 있습니다.
If you visit Jerusalem and also you can see the tomb of Jesus Christ.
그러나 여러분 이것을 꼭 기억해야 될 줄로 믿습니다.
I'd like to show you, I want you to remember this main important thing.
예수님의 무덤에는 예수님의 시체가 없습니다.
But all everybody has a tomb, but tomb of Jesus, empty tomb.
그 말은 빈 무덤이라는 이야기입니다.
That means empty tomb. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
그 말은 사망의 권세를 깨뜨리고 예수님이 부활했다는 사실입니다.
Empty tomb means Jesus made victory.
그렇기 때문에 십자가의 능력은 승리라는 사실을 기억해야 됩니다.
Therefore, power of the cross means power of Christian lives. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
말씀을 마치도록 하겠습니다.
In conclusion,
사랑하는 여러분,
my beloved brothers and sisters,
십자가의 능력은 구원입니다.
The power of the cross is the power of the salvation.
십자가의 능력은 화해입니다.
The power of the cross is the power of reconciliation.
십자가의 능력은 승리입니다.
The power of the cross means victory.
그렇기 때문에 예수를 바라보시면서
therefore look up Jesus Christ
예수 안에서
in Jesus Christ
날마다
Every day,
말씀 안에서,
in Word of God,
성령 안에서,
in the Holy Spirit,
믿음 충만하시고,
faithful, you have a faithful person.
하나님 앞에 영광 돌리는 여러분 모두 되기를 주의 이름으로 축복합니다.
I want you to be glorified, glory to God through your lives.
Hallelujah. Thank
Hallelujah.
You so
thank
much.
You, Jesus.
Power of the cross, right? Nobody knows the price he paid. Nobody knows the price he paid to see my sins on the cross. That was a great message to remind us all the way from South Korea to come and remind us what the power of the cross is all about. Thank you so very much. Thank you. We feel so honored. And it is just a simple but powerful, powerful teaching to remind us everybody has a grave, everybody has a tomb. But when we go and look for the tomb of Jesus, we can't find him. That means he's alive and the victory. Where is your sting, O death? The victory is there. So we thank God for your message. We're going to do one thing before I bring Bishop Martin. I know the house is waiting to Van and Pastor Temple, who just flew. I want to say thank you. He just flew from Brazil. He landed this morning at 5, and he is here with us, so we will do that. This is what we're going to do. I am going to bring Dr. Gaither to do the offering. Then after we do the offering, we'll take a 5 minutes break, 5 minutes just to stand up, stretch, and then we'll come back, and then we'll have Bishop Martin to speak to us. Then Dr. Rick Temple, we're from Savannah, he will be bringing it home. So, you know, many places we pay a lot of money just to attend a conference like this, but these men and women of God has agreed to come and sow a seed of love as we start the homecoming, as we prepare us to move forward and celebrate 100 years. So, Dr. Gaither, if you would...
come and just do the offering and remind the people. There is an envelope also in there, and I know she's going to say all that, and you can commit yourself, whatever you want to commit for the future, and we thank God for you.
Good morning. I want to honor our president. Can you put your hands together for a man of God, a man of integrity, a man of honor, and a man with a vision? Aren't you glad that we've been told not to despise small beginnings? Because it takes a vision, and a visionary has to see beyond the one or two or three people. And the vision that was started many, many years ago, and the baton that was passed over the years, has been passed to a man of God, who from the time I have known him has walked by faith. And we are now where we are as a result of the vision, as a result of the fact that he has always trusted in God. He recognizes that God uses people, but he has always trusted in God. You were welcomed earlier, but now what I'm going to do is invite you to participate. I honor the speakers, the men, women that God has brought to this place. I honor you as students, the faculty, the staff, the friends, the covenant relationships, the pastors who are here. But I want to invite you now to do something. When you look at these flags, they represent countries. You may never have an opportunity to go there, but what you do when you invest in Beulah Heights University is that you are sowing a seed into the lives of this university, but into the lives of men and women. You may not go, but when you enable this university to equip Christ-centered, there are colleges and universities all over the nation, but they're not always sending forth Christ-centered leaders. Now, I need to say something and challenge each one of us, because we're no longer a Bible college. Why have I been here 24 years? Because I believe that the greatest investment you can ever make is in people. But I need to, for you to hear me, those of you who go here, those of you who have come, you're either in the pulpit or in the marketplace. You're either in the pulpit or in the marketplace. And what we are doing, if there was ever a time that we needed global leaders to take the rightful positions, not just in the pulpit, but in the marketplace. The reason our country, our nation, our world is in the condition it's in is because we don't have enough light overtaking darkness in the marketplace. No, you didn't hear me, because we're no longer just preparing and equipping people in the fivefold ministry. You're either in pulpit ministry or in marketplace ministry. And what you're doing today and what we're doing today is equipping, because when we sow seeds, and you're not just putting money in. And the reason why I want you to take this envelope out is because some of us have already decided how little we can give. But I am challenging you this morning that you understand when you sow a seed, we expect a harvest. And I am challenging you to sow a great seed, because what you do to empower people, no, you may never go to the Congo, South Korea, India, Africa. But when you sow a seed that empowers Beulah Heights University to empower, develop, become a change agent for the world, you get credit. Paul said, you may not be able to go with me, but everything that you do to empower me, God gives you credit. And I am wanting to challenge, especially those as for this homecoming, those who are alumni. Dr. Karanja, behind you and right under that little black book is a check. Will you bring it to me? It's a check for you. Well, we can do that too. I want to challenge alumni, those of you who have partaken of this place, those of you who have been developed by this place, those of you who are now in position, that you make Beulah Heights University, whether you do it monthly, which is what we do, whether you do it quarterly, but that you put Beulah Heights as part of what you sow. When we sow, we expect a harvest. We're sowing seeds, seeds that will bring forth a harvest. I want to close with this, as then I want you to take the envelope and I want you to plant a seed, your best seed. I was in Kenya. I believe I was in Nakuru. And I was in the marketplace out where they sell, and we call them flea markets here, but they're outdoor markets there. And I went up to this particular vendor, and he had pictures of individuals. And I said, I think I know that young man. Now, I am in Kenya. And I said, I think I know that young man. He said, that's my brother. I said, really? He said, do you know Beulah Heights Bible College? We were at college at that point. My brother, go there. I said, your brother was one of my students. That's why I know him. To go all the way back, or to go all the way to Kenya, and know without a shadow of a doubt that we are producing Christ-centered leaders. Christ-centered leaders. Now, there's some universities that are producing leaders, but we're producing Christ-centered leaders because God told us to take dominion. And I am honored to be a part of such a great university with the staff, with the faculty, with the administration, and most of all, with some of the greatest, the most anointed, appointed, and called students. I am so happy. We're not producing people who want a job. We're producing people who know their assignment. We're not producing people who want a job. We're producing people who know their assignment. I need you now to take this envelope. And this is the envelope that you're not just going to just put something in. But I am challenging you to put a seed in this envelope. A seed that says, I am committed and I am dedicated and I want to be a part of and I want to partner with Beulah Heights University. Become a partner, a regular partner of Beulah Heights. We're about to sow into good and fertile soil. And when you sow into good and fertile soil, you will reap a harvest. Amen? Amen? Let's get our seeds. If you're making checks out, make them out to Beulah Heights University. If you are using credit cards, okay, praise you the Lord. You can do online. We've made everything available for you. The only thing we need you to do is be obedient. And this morning, follow the directions of the ushers. Are they, they're marching? They're coming? Okay, I will pray and then you're gonna, okay. Hold your seat up. Wave it in the air, let's mess up the atmosphere. It is my desire and belief that there are no empty envelopes. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity. We thank you, God, that we can and that you can trust us to partner with Beulah Heights University. God, we thank you for this place called Beulah Heights. We thank you, God, for a place where your presence dwells perpetually, where we come to have an encounter with you every single day. For the president, for the administration, for the staff, for the faculty, for the students, for those who are in covenant relationship, those who love you, those who have come this morning to celebrate the goodness and mercy of God. God, we plant these seeds into good and fertile soil. We believe for a harvest. We believe, God, that as we give, not only is it given back to us, good measures, pressed down, shaken together, overflowing, but that we will have more to give, more to invest, more, God, to support the kingdom assignment, and mostly here at Beulah Heights University. We give you glory and honor. We thank you for allowing us to partner with you this day in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Amen. You didn't say it loud enough. Amen. You still didn't say it loud enough. Amen. Amen.